All right, and we are live with the second installment of the Fall 2014 Professional Development Speaker Series, and we're joined by the Chief Meteorologist of NBC4 New York, all the way from the top market, Miss Janice Huff.
Hello, everybody.
Hi.
So, forecast low down here is 19 tonight, so what about up there? How's it going?
actually, you might be... At least in Central Park, we're predicting 22. You're actually colder. We may have record lows though in the area. I think our record is 18 for Central Park in the morning, but we're predicting 22. So we'll be in the area, but we are expecting some locations outside of the city to either tie or just break the record.
All right, cool.
Yeah.
If there's anyone watching out in the Google world, and for everyone here, if you wanted to give a quick introduction, what you do, who you are, all that fun stuff.
I'm Janice Huff. I'm the chief meteorologist at WNBC-TV in New York. I work on the evening shows, 5 p.m., 6 p.m., 7 p.m., and 11 p.m. newscasts, Monday through Friday. I've been here for... 19 and a half, it'll be 20 years in January, and for the first 10 years, I worked as well on the Today Show, Weekend Today Show, as a meteorologist there. Actually, the first 10 years on Saturdays, the next 6 years on Sundays, so for 16 years, I worked 6 days a week here in New York. Now I have weekends off, yay, and it's a good thing, but I'm just back to Monday through Friday now, working in the local news here. Wow. And I'm a graduate, 1982 graduate of Florida State, the Bachelor of Science in Meteorology.
1982, very cool, very cool.
Yeah. I'm dating myself, it's okay.
Let's see, I don't know why I didn't think of questions before I actually do it. NWA was easier because there was a bunch of other people there. So, in your experience, not just at Florida State, but in the field, do you think in the field of meteorology that there is a reputation that goes with a Florida State University degree in meteorology?
Absolutely. I think that having a degree from Florida State does mean quite a bit, you know, because a steep tradition, at least on the meteorology side of it. I actually worked for the National Weather Service as a student trainee in meteorology when I was still in school at FSU during the summers and Christmas breaks. And I worked with meteorologists at the National Weather Service who actually had some of the same professors that I was about to have, and they had all been out of college like 20 years. So, you know, I worked around a lot of FSU grads, and, you know, so I had a lot of mentors who actually came from Florida State, and that meant quite a bit to me. The reputation of the university, in particular the meteorology department, of course, is world-renowned. So, yes, I do feel that it speaks volumes whenever, you know, people find out that I have a degree from FSU. It definitely brings it to a different level and, you know, puts me in the area or in the echelon with other big universities like Penn State and, you know, like other schools that have meteorology departments that are well-known around the world.
Awesome, awesome. So one question that I had just off my experience today, a few of us had an exam today, and it was pretty rough, really hard.
What exam was it?
Atmospheric physics.
Oh, fun.
definitely, as I'm sure this has happened to other students before, was there a point in the major that you were struggling? Your grades may have not been the best, and how did you manage and go about that?
Oh, but of course they were. I was in that struggle for a bit. I would say, you know, there was one class that I failed. And that was, and you know what, when I found out that the really smart, smart kids, I mean like way smarter than I, failed the class at FSU, I felt better about it, you know, because it happens. it was, I think it was vector analysis, and then I was going to back to take it the following, and then they took it out of the curriculum, so I was very happy I didn't have to go through that again. But you know, yeah, there were times when my grades weren't the best, but then I fought back and I fought hard, and you know, and then there were times where my grades were really great, like in dynamics, and it made me push forward, like, okay, I can do this. I know I can do this. I just got to buckle down. I have to get with study groups. I just have to do it. So, because I really didn't want to do anything else. At this point, I was probably in, you know, my third, you know, year, and I really just wanted to continue with meteorology. And the only other major I thought about while I was at FSU was geography. And I would have possibly switched over to that, but I was glad I didn't have to. There was maybe one other class that I had to take over because I didn't like the grade that I got. So I didn't feel it was my best. And, you know, there are a lot of kids, as you know, not just in meteorology, but lots of majors, they drop out, particularly if they are mathematics based and lots of physics and stuff. It's hard, you guys know. You just buckle down and you just stay there until you finish it, you know, however long it takes. At least that was my philosophy. Thank goodness I was out of school in 4 years and one, 4 years, actually, yeah, 4 years, so.
All right, cool. So do you feel, I guess this is kind of a little bit of a loaded question, but do you feel, as someone that came from that meteorology background and got that degree, that sometimes you have a higher level of scientific skill than maybe other people in the broadcasting field?
Yeah, you know, it does. I would say it nudges at you sometimes because, and the reason why is just like with anything, you think about all the blood, sweat, and tears you put into being at school there. How much work it was and how much it took and, you know, the sacrifices you had to make sometimes in order to, you know, maybe you couldn't hang out at a party or maybe you couldn't, you know, do this or that. So, yeah, I mean, I would get a little annoyed by that. I mean, in the beginning, I think I would get really upset about it at first. But then, you know, the longer you're in the television news industry, you realize that sometimes it's not about all the degrees you have. You don't have to have any degrees, actually, to do some of the work that's done, you know, on in broadcast. You have to have, you have to be a person who's thirsty for knowledge, though, I think, in order to be successful at it. You have to be smart still. In order to be successful, I think you will see a lot of people who come along who may not have as intense a background that I might have in meteorology or somebody might have in history or something like that. Maybe they're great presenters, but they study and they learn things that they need to learn, and maybe sometimes they don't, and that shows. It always shows if you're not smart, if you're not talented, if you're not meant to be there legitimately. That always shows. So, you know, yeah, I mean, of course, it's a bit of annoying when someone calls themselves a meteorologist and they've not had one class in atmospheric dynamics. I mean, well, yeah, that would annoy me. I mean, but you know, TV is different from, let's say, research or being a professor or getting a PhD. It's different. You don't have to have a PhD to do weather on TV. You don't have to have a master's. You don't even have to have a bachelor's degree. I mean, but what you have to have is talent, you know, and if you're willing to learn so that you can be well versed in whatever your field is or whatever your area is, that will show. You know, it will show.
So what do you think, and this is a question that's always kind of been on my mind, is what do you think is the biggest difference between doing the weather for your local audience like you do in New York or doing the weather for a national audience on the Today Show or on the night?
One thing I was going to say also before I forget, too, is, and then I already forgot what it was. Anyway, let me go back to what I was saying. What's the difference, and how is it different? And, you know, there are, like, different entities. You know, on a national scale, you're having to talk about weather from coast to coast, or something that's, you know, maybe not affecting your area, but some other areas. The timing is different. You know, you don't, which one hit on a national show like Nightly News or even the Today Show is usually like a minute. Sometimes they'll call me up, but you'll have 45 seconds. And I'll go, okay, let me see how I can get all of that in 45 seconds. So you have to be concise. I know when you guys are learning broadcast meteorology and you're doing shows on TV there, you have a lot of time. You know, because when I look at the tapes of you guys when I come down, there's, you know, you get like 3, 4, 5 minutes. I sometimes do not know what I would do with that much time anymore, unless it's like a major event, like big hurricane, big severe weather outbreak, those kinds of things. So you have to learn on a network level, on a national level, to be more concise and precise and get as much the important information in a short period of time. And even in local news, unless there is a major weather event in the area, I average about 2 minutes and 15 seconds every broadcast, every time I'm on. Sometimes it's more, it's supposed to be 2:30, but some, you know, usually subtracting from that. Sometimes I get 2:45, 2 minutes and 45 seconds, if I'm really lucky. But on an average day, it's between 2 minutes and 2 minutes, 30 seconds. The other day, today I was about to go on the air on our 6 o'clock news, and something had happened. There was a bunch of breaking news earlier in the show, so that took some time. And they said, you have 2 minutes and 10 seconds. I said, 10 seconds? That's kind of an odd number, 10 seconds. Usually it's like 2:15, 2:30, like that, 2:45. But, you know, with local, it's, of course, hyper-local. You get to talk about the area weather and the different locations in the area. You have more time to spend on everything. And on national, it's usually like a one.
We're breaking up with you a little bit. Let me check my connection real quick. Oh, that's weird.
Are we good? I see you now.
Oh yeah, we got all right. We got you now.
Okay.
All right. What were you saying? Like the last 30 seconds or so.
Oh, sorry. Well, you know where you. I think I was just saying how with national, you have to be pretty concise with your time. And it's, you know, with the local, you're basically hyper-local and talking about local weather. We don't really get a chance to talk about much national weather in local. They like to stick to hyper-local, but if there's absolutely nothing going on, or if there's something that's headed our way that's coming from, you know, like the Great Lakes or the Midwest, then we can, you know, show that and we talk about it a little bit.
All right.
I have a question. I was wondering... Hey, how much time do you put into getting ready for your broadcast? Like you said, you do mostly evening shows, so do you come like in the morning or after lunch? Like I expect like some amount of time goes into preparing what you're going to do for that evening on all your shows.
Well, luckily for me, I have a weather producer who's also a meteorologist, so I have help here. There's always, unless it's, you know, vacation season, you know, outside of sweeps months, November and February and May. So that person comes in around 11 in the morning because they also do our noon, and then they produce graphics for the afternoon. So a lot of the prep work is done for me. On days when no one's here and it's me, it's pretty easy. We have the WSI Max TrueView Max system, weather graphics, and it's the latest and greatest. And you can put together a show very quickly with the new graphics now. I mean, on a regular basis, I mean, I can come if I have to do graphics myself in like 20 minutes. I've got all my graphics done, maybe less. On a big weather day, of course, it takes a little bit more time, but. Everything's so much faster now. So, you know, if there's a snowstorm or something like that, we're all here anyway. Like, our team is here, and we're all working together. But on an average day, I usually get here around 2:30 in the afternoon, sit down with the meteorologist, go over everything, decide what's happening. Sometimes we get the newsroom calls and they want us to cover a particular thing. Most times we just decide what we're going to do within that time frame. I'm here for about a half hour with them, and then I go start to get ready. We have two anchors and myself. We have to get ready for 5 o'clock usually. Our 5 o'clock news is an hour, but we have two separate anchor teams, one from 5 to 5:30, one from 5:30 to 6. I do the weather for all of them. And so everybody has to get into the makeup room at the, you know, we don't want to all be in there at the same time. And ladies will know this, we have 3 women who have to be ready by 4 o'clock every day. So after I, you know, go over everything with my meteorologist, then that's where I go to get ready. And then we come back out, and then we have to do teases for the show, record weather for the taxi cabs in New York City. We appear in the taxis, the back of taxis every day, all day long. And so you could get in the taxi in New York City, and all of a sudden I could pop up and talk about a little short snippet of the weather forecast that's for the tonight and the next day. And then our news team also does like a news piece in it too. So we have to do all those things before 5 o'clock. So we have from 4 o'clock to five. Oh, and we have a hit on the on one of the radio stations here in New York that we have to do at like 4:45. So there's a bunch of stuff to do within that hour. And then it's 5 o'clock, just like that, before you know it. But of course, on a big weather day, there's a lot more prep and a lot more going on.
Yes, thank you.
Okay. And you're AMS certified, right?
Yes.
What is your biggest, like, pro tip, if you will, for getting the AMS CBM?
Well, I am not a CBM. I'm grandfathered in. I'm one of the old AMS seal holders, number 377, as a matter of fact. And I don't have my CBM. I'm probably not going to get it. I mean, at this stage of my career, I'm probably not going to do that. But for any of you who, and of course you will be going for it at some point if you're doing broadcast, the key really to your seal is you have to be explanatory without being preachy or like you're standing in front of a classroom. You have to give the information that's necessary. You have to remember who you're talking to. You have an audience, but you're talking to one person. What does one person want to know when they sit down and watch the TV, when they want information, when they want weather information? What do you want when you sit down in front of the TV and want weather information? You have to make sure that all those basic things are there. For the most part, most people really only want to know what's the temperature now, what's the forecast, you know, or what's the 7 day. But you got to fill that time if you're getting a seal. You can't just say that and be gone, you know. So you do graphics with, you know, your fronts and other things too. And you want to tell a story. It's all about telling a story, where there is a story from beginning, middle, and end. So in the beginning, you basically talk about what's happening now. You might, if there was something significant earlier in the day, of course, in the morning, like if there were record low temperatures, or if you had a tornado that morning or something like that, then you could talk about that and then go to the now. And the middle of the story, the meat, the body, is the part that's explaining what's happening and where the weather's coming from and why. And then you get to the end, of course, that's your forecast. And you want to be as conversational and one-on-one as possible. The person on the other side of the camera, and for you, it is just one person. Even though there are multitudes of people watching, you are speaking to a camera, and on that side, other side of the camera, you have to imagine it's just one person that you're talking to. That's how you make it conversational and personal and personable, you know? That's the thing. Those are the things I think are really key in making sure that, of course, that you're well-versed in your subject matter, and you all are. So you don't want to talk about ice bars. I mean, Tom Skilling still does. There's not that many people that – he's in Chicago. There's not that many people that do still those kinds of things. He's allowed because, you know, he's the, you know, the king of graphics. Back in the day, he would do like 17 graphics, and it was before we had WSI and all this other stuff. But you're not going to talk about things that are too technical sometimes. Or if you do, you should explain what it is and why you're showing it. But really, it's all about showing your knowledge, your expertise, and your personality, really.
All right. Does anyone have questions for Janice?
Hey, hey, hey.
Well,
hi.
In terms of, because I've heard kind of mixed things depending on the person, but what are kind of, if you could, like, three things that you look for when you're, and say that you're having the decision on who to hire, what are things that stand out to you that you would like to see in a tape?
Well, if only I could hire, then it would be a totally different story here. You know what's interesting is that basically, if I were looking at a tape, and people send me things all the time, I'm going to see how well you connect with me when you are standing there on camera in front of your graphics. Are you connecting with me? Am I understanding you? Are you legible? Do you look like you or sound like you know what you're talking about? Am I getting the information I need without too much other stuff going on? How do you interact with the anchor team? Are you pleasant? Are you, do you seem like you get along? If there's a breaking weather situation, if there's severe weather, do you understand what you're trying to, are you understanding what you're trying to tell me? And am I getting the information I need to get from you? That's really it. You have to connect. And when a news director looks at a tape or a video, if you don't connect with them within the first 5 or 6 seconds or 10 seconds at the most, they're not going to go any farther than that. And part of that is something that you have nothing to do with. Part of that is very subjective. That is what this business is. How many of you guys want to do TV? All of you? Or some of you? Okay.
Yes.
All right, cool. It's very subjective. Occasionally, they're just looking for someone to do weather. But sometimes there's a requirement that's unspoken. Like they're looking for a female. They're looking for a mature 30-something-year-old guy. Or they're looking for someone who's blonde. Or they're looking for, you know, there's all these like physical things that you know, when you send them the tape, you know there's an opening. They're not gonna tell you all those things. But that's why, even though you may be very good at what you're doing, very good on camera, you're doing all the right things, but you may not get the job, it's because that news director may be looking for something very specific. They might want a master's in meteorology, more than likely not, but they might, you know, they may not need an actual meteorologist. Just, you know, maybe they're in, I don't know, somewhere in California where, you know, it's sunny a lot. So they just want someone who's entertaining or someone who has a big personality or can go out and do live shots and talk to people. It's really subjective. So what you have to do is just do the best that you can. And when you send out your videos and stuff, and maybe if you can find out, you know, ahead of time if that, what they're looking for, but you just have to put your best foot forward. And some of the things you won't have any control over.
All right.
Does that answer part of that question?
Yeah.
Always look your best. You know, it is a visual medium, so look professional, you know, keep it simple. That's always the best thing. But, you know, show them who you are, you know, without trying to be somebody else. That's really the key to what we do. Everybody's got a different way of doing things. Everybody looks different. Everybody's got a different personality. It's all up, but you want to show off your best qualities, you know, who you are to them and not somebody else.
Yeah, kind of talking about that with being throwing your own personality into your forecasts. That's something I've been trying to work on because I feel like whenever I'm put on camera, I'm not, you know, I try to kind of put my personality, but it's difficult because you want to have this like persona that you're a professional, but it's like that balance in between. I find it difficult personally to put it in. but I'm trying.
Yeah. Well, that's good, though. You're trying, and you'll find a balance. Sometimes, one thing that you guys will realize, you really sometimes don't hone in or zero in on that special thing until you actually get your first job and start working around other professionals. And then you start to pick up being positive things from other people around you. See, all of you right now are students. And even though you can feed off of each other and pick up positive qualities and positive thing feedback, you still are learning. And so when you get in a professional environment, you're going to learn a lot more that much faster. So, you know, don't get discouraged because just yet. It may not until you actually get your first job. The key is to get your first job. And how do you get your first job? First of all, you don't limit yourself to where you will take your first job. I don't care if it's, you know, Butte, Montana. If it's a job and that's the only job you have or only prospect you have and you really want to do this, you will go to the end of the earth to do it. It won't matter. You don't have to stay in Butte, Montana for the rest of your life unless you really like it there. So, and you might, who knows? So, you know, you just have to get your first job and be open to all possibilities.
To bounce off that a little bit, like Ian was saying about trying to maintain a professional image, do you think there's such a thing as overdoing your personality or letting too much of it show?
I think there is such a thing as maybe being fake or phony, you know, to the point where you are overexpressing yourself. I mean, listen, some people have very quiet and calm personalities in person, and then when they get on camera, they light up the screen, but then when they get back off, they're like, you know, very quiet. That happens. I mean, some people are really good performers, and so they light up. Off-camera personality may be a little less dynamic. I don't know if you guys remember Rich Johnson, who used to be on the Weather Channel. Do you guys ever remember him? He's been gone for like 5 years now. But he was on the Weather Channel for about 20 years. And Rich Johnson is also a graduate of FSU. He and I had classes together at FSU. He was like a year or two behind me. But Rich Johnson was a really nice, really cool, nice, smart guy who you never in a gazillion years would have ever thought, I didn't, that he would end up on television. He was nice looking. He was mannerable. He was pleasant. He had a very nice personality. He was kind of soft-spoken, really smart, but he just never talked about TV or anything like that. And next thing I know, he goes to the Weather Channel. He gets a job, I think, like as a forecaster or like a graphics producer or something. And then the next thing I know, I look up one day and I see this guy standing on camera, and his name is Rich Johnson. I'm like, the Rich Johnson I went to school with? I can't believe that's the same guy. I was really surprised. But he was the Rich Johnson that I saw on camera, and he actually came to one of the workshops maybe 2 years ago, I think. He came. He was very much the rich guy, that guy that I knew in school. But he wasn't trying to overdo it. He wasn't trying to be somebody else. He was himself. But he loved weather so much. It was very easy to listen to him. He connected with the audience. He wasn't over the top. He played it by the, you know, he was at the Weather Channel for like 20 years. So, yes, yeah, sometimes it can be a bit much if it's not genuine. You know what I mean? If it's genuinely you, then that's fine. I think people will know that, you know, if it is, or isn't.
All right. Yeah. Any other questions for Janice?
Everybody's so quiet.
I have one more question to finish us off then.
Okay.
FSU still undefeated. Woo. College football playoff rankings came out about an hour ago. Still number 3. Now
Wait. I thought we were number 1.
In AP and the coaches poll, but in the college football playoff poll, which is one that matters, we're still number 3 behind Alabama and Oregon. Thoughts?
They put Alabama in front of us?
Yes.
Okay. Who do I write to? Because I'm about to go on Twitter.
I feel like they will listen to you because you have some clout.
Oh my God! I can't believe this. I said to somebody today. I said, if we are not number one after this weekend, I am writing to the NCAA. Where is? I'm gonna follow them right now. No joke. I am. No, it's not the NCAA. Who is it? The coaches? What'd you say it was?
It's the College Football Playoff Committee.
Do they have a Twitter account?
I'm not sure. Let's find out.
College football playoff. No, I don't think they have a. What is the ESPN? No. What is the CFB?
That's
it, isn't it? Okay, I'm following that right now. And now it's time. As soon as I get off the phone with you guys, this is what I am doing. I mean, the nerve. The nerve. I mean, this is why I don't like all this stuff. It's like, let the computer do it. They did just fine. Although my husband said something like they had to change it because they have some contract that they can only do certain things a certain way for so many years or something. I don't know.
Well, we're happy to get your thoughts on that. That was a nice interview.
Thank you.
So thanks to everyone here, and thank you, Janice, for joining us.
You're welcome. Thank you all for having me. It was great to see you guys.
And thanks for tuning in. Like, this will also be on YouTube for people to watch it, if anyone here wants to advertise to their friends. All that fun stuff. Janice, if you want to advertise it to your friends, maybe they want to talk to us.
Would love to.
And we will go off air. Have a great night.